خراب يخرج خروج الملحمة، خراب يخرج خروج الملحمة. خروج الملحمة فتح القسطنطينية. Although the Arabs say Constantinia, but Imran says Constantinia. فتح القسطنطينية خروج الدجال. That when Jerusalem is rising, built up, center stage in the world, look to see whether Medina is going down and down and down. This one going up, that one going down. This one center stage in the world, that one is a forgotten relic in forlorn desolation, playing absolutely no role at the stage of the world. When that is the state of affairs, then look for the occurrence of the Malhama. When the Malhama takes place, the next event to come after that would be the conquest of Constantinople. Ever heard that word before? It's been banished. It's now illegal to use the term, the word Constantinople. You use that in Turkey, they throw you in jail. I wonder why. If Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam referred to a city by the name Constantinople, would that not be the Sunnah? Yes, it's a Sunnah. And yet Mustafa Kemal and a bunch of Zionists who took over Turkey have banished the word Constantinople, replaced it with another word. I really need to mention the name. And have now made it illegal to use the name Constantinople. I find that to be sinister. I find that to be mysterious. And I say, if we are a people who think, and Allah sent the Quran, لِكَوْمِ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ, to a people who think, then we question, why did they do that? Then the hadith goes on to say that after the conquest of Constantinople would come the خُرُوج الدَّجَّال, where the Dajjal will now appear in human form as a Jew, etc. So in this, there is a big war called the Malhama. It's a unique war, because it is the Malhama, the great war, Malhama to Kubra. And do we have anything else in the Hadith about this war? So let's go and search for it. And yes, we find in Sahih Bukhari that the river Euphrates will uncover a mountain of gold. And people will fight for that gold. And 99 out of every 100 would be killed. And each would say, I am the one who will survive. But the Muslims must not touch that gold. We have discarded that methodology about a mountain of the metal coming in, coming out from underneath the river. But if you are persuaded that is what the hadith is saying, then we say to you, by all means, you can stay with that. No need for any boxing gloves. We're moving on. We are moving on. We say that there's something underneath the river which is huge in quantity and is symbolized by the use of the word mountain, and which one day is destined to function as gold. And we say it's oil. otherwise known as black hole. And we say that this has already occurred. This has already occurred. We don't have the time tonight to give a lecture on monetary economics, to take you to the Bretton Woods Accord, to take you to the International Monetary Fund. We don't have that time tonight. But there are lectures of ours which you can listen to. Up to 1971, the US dollar had an element of legitimacy, a fig leaf to hide its nakedness. That international law made it obligatory on the United States of America to redeem US dollars for gold. You can bring your US dollars to the United States and demand that you get the gold for it at the rate of how much? You can't answer me, I'm going home. How much? $35 an ounce. 35 US dollars for 1 ounce of gold. And the rest of the world of paper money was nothing else but paper. And they had to hang on to the coattails of the US dollar to have any semblance of legitimacy. This was a monetary system that was bogus and fraudulent and manifestly haram. But the world of Islam long ago stopped thinking. The scholars of Islam stopped thinking. And I make no apologies for the harshness of my language. It is Allah who will judge whether my language is appropriate or not. We stop thinking, even though Allah sent the Quran to a people who think. And so this bogus monetary system lasted until 1971, when the French once again, brought US dollars. Knock, 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 Uncle Sam, are you there? Come on, we want the gold. But this time, the United States got scared. Because who knows what's going to happen tomorrow? We have printed more paper than we have gold. So if Saudi Arabia joins the line, and Kuwait joins the line, what's going to happen? The bank will bust, go to jail. You print more paper than you have gold, it's fraudulent. So the United States announced that we're no longer going to redeem dollars for gold. They gave their word and they said we don't have to keep our word. That is the United States of America. Since 1971 then, the US dollar was in no man's land. It had nothing to back it up. Between 71 and 73, it remained in no man's land. And in 1973, they gave us the Arab-Israeli war. They knew, oh yes, they knew, that King Faisal had warned, had threatened, that he was going to impose an oil boycott on the United States of America. You know, in those days, you actually had a Saudi with that home. Yes. And when the war started, Saudi Arabia imposed an oil boycott on the United States. And there were motor cars lined up for one night and more to buy gasoline in those days. And what happened was predictable. The price of oil rose because of the boycott, demand and supply, by 400%. From $3 a barrel to 12. And the Arab oil producing countries were now 400% richer. These are the good times. And the US dollar fell in value by 400% from $40 a barrel, sorry, $40 an ounce of gold to 160. This was when the Zionists pulled off the greatest stunt in all of history. And an ocean of oil began to function as a mountain of gold. Henry Kissinger went to Saudi Arabia and convinced King Faisal, who didn't have the knowledge, that if you sell your oil for only US dollars, you're going to see that what you're getting now is peanuts. You're going to become so wealthy, he didn't use these words, that if you go and try to give zakat, you'll not find anybody to accept your zakat. You remember the hadith? You remember? And he fell for it. And Faisal then got the other Arab oil producing countries to join with him in this fraudulent gang. And then they brought into being the greatest creation of the Zionist world on all human history, something called OPEC. And the oil producing and exporting countries of the world, members of OPEC, abided by this unwritten law that oil can only be sold for US dollars. So the US dollar didn't have gold anymore. It now became a petrodollar. And this monetary system now, which has no links with gold, now became known as the petrodollar monetary system. And that is what the Prophet was referring to when he prophesied that the river Euphrates will uncover a mountain of gold. If the world is convinced that this is the correct interpretation of the hadith, alhamdulillah. But Allah knows best. There's no obligation on anyone. If you want to wait for the mountain of the metal to come out from under the river, then by all means you can wait. But the hadith goes on to say they're going to fight over this mountain of gold. In other words, the petrodollar monetary system is destined to lead to a big war. How big? It will be a war like no other war has ever been in all of human history. How do we know that? There's never been a war in human history in which 99 out of every 100 have been killed. Do you know of any such war? No. If this is going to be a unique war in all of human history, and it's going to be so catastrophic that 99 out of every 100 will be killed, then we say this is the war in which weapons of mass destruction will have to be used. And therefore, a nuclear war, or thermonuclear war, or whatever other weapons they have that did not disclose it yet. We say, therefore, this is the Malhama. That the Malhama will be fought in order to protect the petrodollar monetary system. How far away from us is that war? Is the petrodollar monetary system under attack today? Yes, it is. Who is launching the attack? Answer: Russia is the leader. And so long as Russia leads, China is there with Russia. But if Russia doesn't lead, China is already there. So Russia and China are the two heavyweights who are challenging the petrodollar. dollar monetary system. And there are three lightweights with them, Brazil, and South Africa, and India. We need not spend any time on the lightweights. We're concerned with the heavyweights. When BRICS came into being, and BRICS caught on and was able to convince many in the world, especially the poor, that there was something fundamentally wrong with the petrodollar monetary system. The implication of the success of BRICS in convincing the majority was that nuclear war now became inevitable. And what we have been seeing since BRICS came into being is called shadow boxing. They had to fish for a reason to attack Russia. And it was while fishing for a reason to attack Russia that they came up with this color revolution to overthrow the legitimately or democratically elected government of Ukraine. And then this government immediately began policies that were manifestly provocative to Russia. And now we are at that point in time where you can see the movement towards war taking place and the inevitability of that war. They are making it plain and clear that they will move on Russia. It's just a matter of time. But the good news that I have for you is that Russia is not backing down. As the Russian president said, Vladimir Putin, he said, "Don't mess with nuclear Russia." And so nuclear war is now inevitable. And that is what we're talking about. The meltdown. But why should the Zionists be so happy? Why should they be so keen for nuclear war to take place? If we are a people who think, we would want to know why. The answer is located in eschatology, in the study of the Akhiru Zaman, the end time, in which we find Al-Masih al-Dajjal, or Dajjal who seeks to impersonate the true Messiah. In order for him to convince the Jews, he doesn't have to convince any Muslim. No. Dajjal has to convince the Jews that he is the Messiah, Al-Masih. In order for him to convince the Jews that he is the Messiah, he has to do a number of things that we explained in our book, Jerusalem in the Quran. Some of you may have read it. Others may have bought the book, but you couldn't find time to read it. Number one, he has to liberate the Holy Land for the Jews. Because both the Bible and the Quran says that Allah gave the land to the Jews. Open to Israel. Both the Bible and the Quran says that Allah gave the land to the Israelite people. It's another matter that Allah did not give the land unconditionally. He gave condition, but that's another matter. Number two, he's got to bring the Jews back to the Holy Land to reclaim it as their own. Because remember, they expelled, and for 2,000 years they exiled, even in Canaan. Number three, he has to restore the holy state of Israel, the one built by Nabi Dawud alayhi salam, Nabi Sulaiman alayhi salam. So he has to create a state of Israel and convince the Jews that this is holy Israel. Number four, in the same way in which that Israel ruled the world, in that sense of the word, this Israel must also rule the world. And if you want to know in what sense did that Israel rule the world, just go to Nabi Suleiman alayhi salam and the Queen Bilqis, Queen of Saba. And there you see something about the ruling state. Well, the Dajjal has already accomplished number one, number two, number three. But how is this Israel going to rule the world? Israel is too small. So either Israel has to become big, 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 or the world has to become smaller and smaller and smaller. Which one will be? Answer, the Zion is no. That Israel cannot become big, 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 big. So it has to be the world becoming smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. So that's why they're looking forward to the Malchama. They want Russia and the Western world, NATO. They want them to have this nuclear war. Because at the end of the nuclear war, their calculation is that nothing will be left in the world after that that will pose an obstacle for Israel to take over as the ruling state in the world. The people of the United States of America, of Britain, of France, of Europe, who may Allah take these words to them? Because all they do is watch television. And television destroys your capacity to think. So go ahead and let your children keep on watching TV. Go ahead and let your children, I don't call them kids, you call them kids. I say only goats and Americans are kids. Let your children keep on watching television and see whether they will ever grow up to be a people with the capacity to think. That's the greatest danger of all of television. They cannot think anymore. In the United States and Britain and France are those countries which are inundated by the media, brainwashing. And yet they are the ones who will be destroyed in nuclear war. One nuclear weapon, one, was able to destroy the whole city of Hiroshima. One. And then another nuclear weapon destroyed the whole city of Nagasaki. And what they have today makes those nuclear weapons look like peanuts. Today's nuclear weapons are far, far, far more powerful than what was used in 1945. So when these nuclear weapons explode, it's going to be destruction, mass destruction, for the combatants, the two parties that are going to be fighting. How many will die? Can any nuclear scientist tell us how many people will die in the nuclear war that is coming? We Muslims say, well, we don't need to go to any nuclear scientist for that, because Nabi Muhammad already told us that 99 out of every 100 would be killed. One in 100 will survive. My understanding is he's talking about the combatants, those who are going to be fighting. And those who are not directly involved in the war are the periphery of the war. I say the ones who die in nuclear war are the lucky ones. Yes. I say than the ones who survived the nuclear war are the unlucky ones. Why? Because of what the world is going to be like. Post-mortem, this is why this subject is so important. The first thing we want to say about the world post-mortem is that the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, about the Malkama, the birds flying in the sky will fall down. Because they can't navigate anymore. The entire atmosphere is polluted with radiation. So aeroplanes won't fly anymore. Cruise missiles can't fly anymore. But after the Malhama, after the conquest of Constantinople, after the Furuj of Dajjal, after all of this, comes Dajjal will come from the east. And when he comes from the east, he's going to be riding on a donkey. And the donkey will have his ears stretched out wide. And the donkey will travel as fast as the clouds. The Salafi, because of his feet being concrete on that methodology, will have to wait for the flying donkey. But we say it's the aircraft. And the fact that the Israeli Air Force can still fly after the Malhama indicates that the Zionists will have the technology in a world post-Malhama to be able to fly the aircraft. If they have that technology to be able to fly the aircraft, then I come to the conclusion that the banking system will survive. That the electronic money can survive. And that the petrodollar monetary system will no longer be needed for small amounts. That paper money and plastic money will be no longer needed. And that electronic money or digital money will now replace the petrodollar monetary system. And we already see the ugly head of that electronic money raising itself. We already see it. When the world is embraced universally by an electronic monetary system, I recognize that to be the equivalent of a financial Guantanamo. Because you can't take your money out of the bank. No, there's nothing to take out. It's invisible, it's intangible. No. The same lack of capacity to think that today characterizes the world of Islamic scholarship. And my words are harsh, but this time somebody speaks. Actually, that same blindness is likely to lead to the fatwa that in the same way the paper money is halal, the electronic money is halal. But no, it's haram, it's bogus, fraudulent. And it will be the equivalent of a financial Guantanamo. Every single transaction that you make in buying and in selling will be recorded. And the Christians know this already. Yes, it is the government. And they can track you down. They can discover your profile. Because you have an electronic trail, no need for a paper trail anymore. And when they see a profile that disturbs them, they can freeze your bank account. Who are you going to complain to? Imran Hussein? That's where we're heading for. I come to the conclusion that in the same way that when Britain became the ruling state of the world with Pax Britannica, Britain had a monetary system over which she ruled with the British sterling pound as the universal currency. And I came to the conclusion that when the United States of America replaced Britain with Pax Americana, the sterling pound had to give way and the US dollar took over. And because the United States was able to rule the world of money, the United States became the second ruling state. So the Charles Day, like a year, gave way to the Charles Day, like a month. And I came to the conclusion in Jerusalem in the Quran, which was written 12, 14 years ago, that when the Dajjal moves to a day which is like a week, and Israel replaces the United States of America with a Pax Judaica, he will have to have a new monetary system. And so I come to the conclusion today, and I'm saying this for the first time, that it is post-Malam, after the Malam, when universal electronic money takes over, and the petrodollar monetary system is history, that the Dajjal's day, like a week, would commence. I may be wrong by a few years, but not more than that. How long will a day like a week last? That's not our subject for tonight. Our subject is, what do we do in a world post-Malam, when you have a universal electronic monetary system? Those who are comfortable living in the embrace of the Dajjal, that's their choice. But the Prophet ﷺ told us we must not touch that goal, indicating that the Muslim world must withdraw from that monetary system. If we have been ordered to withdraw from that monetary system, which is now collapsed, how can we be permitted to be embraced by this monetary system, which is worse than that? So who then are the true followers of Muhammad in the world post-Malam? Answer: it will be those who withdraw from the embrace of the electronic monetary system. And there's only one way you can withdraw from that embrace, and that is to get out of the cities. Get out of the cities and go into the periphery or the remote countryside and build small markets, micro markets. And in your micro market, you return to the money which is the Sunnah and the money which is in the Quran. But the world of Islamic scholarship has forgotten it. And Islamic banks don't want you to remember it. No. Namely, the gold dinar and silver dirham. But is that all in the world post-Malam? No, that's not all. The nuclear scientists are the ones who will have to tell us what would be the impact on the environment with nuclear weapons exploding so clean. And I am not a nuclear scientist. But I know that one of the signs of Akhirul Zaman is Dukhan, smoke. Smoke. And I can assume then that maybe the Prophet ﷺ is talking about the mushroom clouds which come from nuclear weapons exploding, blocking out the sky, so no sunlight. No sunlight means no heat. No heat means it's going to be freezing cold. If it's going to be freezing cold, what do we do? Answer, you better learn how to build a mud hut, because the mud wall will keep you warm inside when it's cold outside, and cool inside when it's hot inside, hot outside. And a small enclosure so that body heat can keep that small enclosure tolerably warm. But what I am concerned about post-madhama is more than the dukkha. The prophet said about Dajjal, and I believe that this is post-madhama, that he's going to take control of the climate. He's going to cause the rain to fall, and when he causes the rain to fall, it really falls, as Pakistan knows. It's going to have massive flooding, which will not be baraka, but which will destroy animals, livestock, produce in the fields, houses, people drowning, everything washing away. He will control the climate. Not only will he cause the rain to fall, he'll stop the rain from falling. That's the more dangerous one. The Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, and you actually don't hear all these hadiths, you know. You don't hear about it. That one year, he will stop one third of the rain from falling. You know it? And one third of the crops will not grow. And then the second year, he will stop two thirds of the rain from falling. And two thirds of the crops will not grow. And in the third year, he will stop the rain from falling completely. No rain. And nothing will grow. And every hoofed animal will die. So I asked myself, but wait a minute. If no rain falls, you still have the lake. You still have the springs, you still have the rivers. So what about them? And then I remembered Gog and Magog. Yes. That when Gog and Magog are released, they're very thirsty. And they'll drink up all the water of the world. They'll pass by a river and drink it dry. Not only that, but they have PhDs in fasad. Fasad is to corrupt in such a way that you destroy. And so they give us this marvelous system of taking the toilet and bringing it inside the house. And this other marvelous system of getting all the people to leave the villages and converge upon the city. So you get mega cities. They cannot succeed in corrupting and polluting and destroying all the water of the world without bringing everybody into the cities and putting all the toilets into the homes and then giving us a sewage system that nobody bothers about. And then they will pump, even when they say they're not doing it, they're lying. They will pump the sewage into the rivers, into the lakes, into the coastal waters, and so corrupt and pollute the water, it cannot be used. It cannot be used. The fish will eat that sewage, the feces, and when you sit down for dinner, you don't know your next door neighbor had AIDS. Or your next door neighbor had this disease or that disease and it's gone into the fish and you're eating it. And so the sewage system is going to cause diseases to come we never had before. Because Allah gave us a system where you dug a hole in the earth and you buried it. And then the oxygen will cause it to decompose and it becomes harmless. But with our intelligence, we put it in water where oxygen cannot reach it. So it remains in pristine purity until you eat it in the fish. So there is no water. And if there is no water, there will be no food. And if there is no food, there is going to be famine in the world post-Malha. So the companions asked, O Messenger of Allah, if we are alive at that time, where will we get food from? And he answered, he said, Subhanallah will bring you food. Alhamdulillah will bring you food. Allahu Akbar will bring you food. So put on your thinking caps. Is this going to be Subhanallah somehow or the other being transformed into something nutritious when you utter these words? And suddenly, only with these words, you get enough sustenance to survive? Huh? No. Have you forgotten that Allah is fa'alul lima yurid? That Allah can do whatever He wants to do? Have you forgotten that she was in the mihrab? She was in the mihrab, she was in the mihrab. Today mihrab is this. But in Masjid al-Aqsa, mihrab was a room in which only the chief rabbi could enter. Nobody else. It was called the Holy of the Holies. And she was in that room. And she asked for food. And guess what? Allah sent it for her. So when you ask for food and Allah send it for you, won't you say Subhanallah? When you ask for food and Allah send it for you, won't you say Alhamdulillah? When you ask for food and Allah sends the food for you, won't you say Allahu Akbar? But wait a minute. Are we going to eat only fruits? Curry fish. Can we get cooked food? Allah wants some cooked food. But they did not ask for it. Ask Him. They said to Nabi Isa alayhi salam, ask your Lord. We want food to akuluhunna. We want cooked food. Did Allah not send down the cooked food? Did Allah not send down the cooked food for them? And do we not have a whole surah of the Quran known as Surah Al-Ma'idah? So I come to the conclusion that when the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that at that time you will get food with Subhanallah and Alhamdulillah and Allahu Akbar, what he is saying to us is that if you have faith in Allah and you ask, like she asked in the mihrab, when Allah sends the food to you, you will say Subhanallah, you will say Alhamdulillah, you will say Allahu Akbar. But be careful. Sometimes you say with your lips that you worship Allah. But you're not worshipping Allah, you're worshipping your two gardens. You remember the two gardens? With the river running in between? Come on, shake your head a little bit. Yeah. He was saying you worship Allah with his lips, but with his heart, he was worshipping his wealth, the dunya. And when Allah took it away, what did he say? Ya laytani lam ushrik bi rabbi ahada. That this was shirk. So be careful. Be careful that you worship Allah not only with your lips, but also with your heart. And Allah says, watch it. وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ. Be conscious of the fact that Allah hovers between a man and his heart. For the rest, no food, because no water. So where will you get food from? Answer, you have to go to Israel. And you have to bow down and submit to Israel, because they stop fighting food. What should we do? In addition to faith in the heart, we will have to also stockpile food and water. And where to do it? Not in the city. Because post-Malhama, what's going to happen in the cities? The lines of supply are going to be disrupted. So food cannot reach the mega cities. Water cannot reach the mega cities with 20 million people. And when the search for food and water turns violent, you wouldn't want to be in the city with some food stocked up in your house, because they'll break down every door you have and kill whoever they have to kill, because they're hungry and they're dying. It'll be a dog-eat-dog world post-Malhama in the cities and towns. But if you are in the remote countryside in a small community, you can live as a family, and each one can help the other. And you can share what you have. That's a better world to live in the world post-Malhama. So, money, watch it. Water, watch it. Food, watch it. One more and we finish. It is not by accident that Dajjal has taken control of oil. Everywhere in the world where oil is located, the Zionists want to control it. That's why you have Brunei. You can, Brother Sultan, you can enforce all the Sharia that you want in Brunei. My dear Brother Sultan, you can't fool anybody. It is the Zionists who control Brunei, because Brunei has oil. Wherever you have an oil-producing country, and you're not prepared to submit to the Zionists, you call a terrorist state. And from the time Mohammad Mossadegh in Iran attempted to take control of Iranian oil in 1952, from the time Dr. Mohammad Mossadegh attempted to nationalize Iranian oil, to take it out of the grips of the Zionists, what did they do? The CIA toppled him in a CIA-arranged coup d'etat. So they could take control of the oil. They don't like the fact that Venezuela is an oil-producing country, and Venezuela is defying them. So they are attacking Venezuela. They don't like the fact that Libya wanted to remain free from debt. They don't like the fact that Libya brought back all this gold into Libya, and did not do the foolishness that Germany did, and leave all the gold in the United States, and now the gold is gone, and Germany is crying. So they attacked Libya. They attacked Libya. They didn't like the fact that Saddam Hussein, and when I met Sheikh Abdulhamid Kish in Egypt, and I sat down with him in his sitting room for about 45 minutes, he had a powerful voice, Sheikh Abdulhamid Kish Rahimahullah, and he said about Saddam Hussein, Shaitan Akbar! Those were the words of Abdulhamid Kish. They didn't like the fact that Iraq under Saddam Hussein was now trying to get out of their grips and sell oil for other than USD. And so they toppled Iraq again. Iraqi regime. This is control over oil. And now they ensure that oil becomes indispensable. Because who travels with horses anymore? Huh? And donkeys. Only a donkey travels with a donkey now. Why? Because all the rest of us have mechanized transport that will not move an inch without oil. And if they control the oil, they control us. Everything stops. Understand? Not only transportation, but also manufacturing. All the factories running on oil. Agriculture is now based on oil. Fertilizers, chemicals. What else is it do we have based on oil? Who was it with an oil lamp? When last did you use an oil lamp? Everything around us now depends on oil. And the world post-Malhama would be a world in which they would exercise total control over oil, which is why Russia has to be taught a lesson. What do we do? Allahumma jalla jalala. What do we do in such a world? Answer? The answer is in Surah Al-Kahf of the Quran. How did they survive for 300 years without dying? وَنُقَلِّبُهُمْ ذَاتَ الْيَمِينِ وَذَاتَ الشِّمَالِ. The bodies were rolling. Rolling to the left and rolling to the right. Rolling in attraction to what? Rolling in attraction to? وَتَرَى الشَّمْسَ إِذَا طَلَعَتْ تَزَاوَرُ عَنْ كَهْفِهِمْ ذَاتَ الْيَمِينِ وَإِذَا غَرَبَتْ تَقْرِضُهُمْ ذَاتَ الشِّمَالِ. The sunlight was entering the cave in the mornings and in the evening, the right side and the left side. And the bodies were rolling to the sunlight. And in the process of absorbing the sunlight, sunlight was being transformed into energy. Is this what is called photosynthesis? Somebody help me. I'm not that big a scientist. If I'm wrong, correct me. I know there's one called phototropism and the other one is called photosynthesis, and I don't know the difference between them. So let me leave that. Sunlight will be transformed into energy. Today it's called solar energy. So Surah Al-Kahf is saying to us, that's the opening that you have. In a world post-Malhama, it is to solar energy that you have to turn. And solar energy is like other forms of natural energy, wind, table mountain, ship. You can capture the wind and transform that wind into energy. Or the waves in the sea. And you can capture the energy from the waves of the sea to transform it into energy. This has been a glimpse of the world post-Malhama. And I've restricted myself to only the state of the world. I have not gone to the events which follow the Malhama. I have not touched on the conquest of Constantinople. I have not touched on the Khuruj of Dajjal. All of this is eschatology. What I would like from those of you who have an appetite for research is that Uncle Imran has done the homework for you at the beginning. These are a few hadiths which I have used to explain to you and describe to you what the world is going to be like post-Malhama. I'm sure that there are other hadiths which can be brought together. If we would only do some thinking, and if Allah blesses us with insight. May Allah bless those who now devote time and attention to this subject. ربنا تقبل منا انك انت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا انك انت التواب الرحيم برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين امين. Can we have the question and answer now after salah? Now, okay. Do we have any questions? All right, our chairman is coming. Yes, right.
Yeah, Chef, would you say the balance?
Great.
Just before we pose questions, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. I just want to also just go through the rules, these ladies as well. So there's a format. So for those who, it would obviously be preferable to pose questions from the floor. But for those who are not able to, or wouldn't like to do it like that, they can write their questions on a piece of paper and pass it forward. I'm sure we'll find a way of doing that. And the ladies as well, if you would like to pose questions, you can either write it on a piece of paper. Is it somewhere that can be around? We'll go fit, or otherwise, ladies can perhaps just throw it out, you know, from the top. So, inshallah, Tafadhol, you wanted to pose a question.
You said the banking system, you believe, will remain post Muhammad. You've also said in previous lectures that Israel are moving to gold as a main standard. Do you believe the banking system remains until that gold standard now takes over and then people follow?
Okay, the question is that there's also an event which is coming, that we know is coming. That Israel will have to give to the world a monetary system based on actual physical gold and silver coins. The question is, how do we relate this to the electronic money? The answer is that electronic money will be the third monetary system. The first was a day like a year and the British sterling pound. The second was a day which is like a month, and the US dollar, the Bretton Woods, and the petrodollar monetary system. And the third, where Israel replaces the United States, and Pax Judaica replaces Pax Americana, and a new monetary system, namely electronic and digital money. All of these must precede, come before, the khuruj of Dajjal. It is when Dajjal appears in human form as a Jew, a young man called Fidbit, etc., it is at that time that Israel will have to return to gold and silver coins. Next question.
Yeah. One of my question is, you were talking about the migrating to the rural countryside. How do you identify the signs when that should take place?
Good question. How do we know when to move? That's what he's asking. How soon will the Malama take place? If you are watching what's happening in the world, you can see the incremental movement towards war with Russia is now inevitable. It can happen any time. I had a dream, and I normally do not broadcast my dreams. So when I choose to share a dream with you, the implication is because I believe it is very important. The dream has application for me. Send message to me, give me knowledge. Up to you to choose if you like to pay any attention to it or not. In the month of September, I was in Iran attending a conference, and I had the same dream twice. Same night. And I saw nuclear war. I saw nuclear missiles being shot into the sky, and I saw Pakistan with a dome. When I woke up from that sleep, I remembered that I had a dream 2 years before 9/11. And that dream came true on 9/11. In fact, when I had the dream, I went on the mimbar and I gave a khutbah in Long Island, in which I mentioned the dream. So there are many who could confirm that yes, they did have this dream. And there was a gap of 2 years between the dream and 9/11. The dream was in 1999, and 2 years later we had 9/11 in 2001. So I assume that we now have a breathing spell of about a year and a half to 2 years left before the meltdown. That's not much time. Those who want to benefit from the dream which I had, and who choose not to believe that we still have maybe 5 or 10 years, would now take steps to find a place in the remote countryside and stock up on food and on water and try to master something of the technology of solar energy. Learn how to build a house with mud boards and learn other survival skills. What to do when there is no sunlight? How do we live in a world in which there is no sunlight? How long will it last? No sunlight. There's a hadith which speaks of 40 days. The Christians say 3 days. There's the quality. But there's a hadith which says 40 days of no sunlight. How do we survive such a time? So survival is given. Next question.
Before taking a question from the floor, there's just one person who wrote this question down. Maybe we can join these two questions, these two. What is the role of Iran in the Mahkama, as well as what is the role of Pakistan in the Mahkama?
Pakistan does not have any special role to play. Rather, Pakistan is going to be a target. The reason why Pakistan is going to be a target is because no Muslims must be allowed to have a weapon of mass destruction. The world of Islam has to be denuclearized. And so Pakistan, it is inevitable that Pakistan will be attacked in the Mahkama in order to destroy Pakistan as a nuclear power. If you destroy Pakistan's nuclear capacity, you also have to break up Pakistan in order to ensure that Pakistan never rises again in the future as a nuclear power. So the breakup of Pakistan into bits and pieces is inevitable. At that time, Pakistan's armed forces and the government in Islamabad raised their hands and made dua to Allah. Would Allah answer their dua? When for all of these years, shamelessly, Islamabad, are you listening to me? Without a semblance of shame on your part, you allow the territory of Pakistan to be used for NATO to transship all the weapons, all the supplies, everything they needed to wage war in Afghanistan and to kill our innocent brothers and sisters and children. Don't you have any shame, Islamabad, and the Pakistan armed forces? No. No. 1,000 times no. No dua of yours will ever be answered. On the contrary, the innocent people of Pakistan, when they see Pakistan breaking up, they will come after you and they will lynch you, and you deserve that lynching. About Iran is different. About Iran is that which I will not speak. No. But there's a question mark. I'm certain that there will be those in Iran who will follow the Mahdi, Imam al-Mahdi, even when they find out he's not Shia. As I'm certain there is some amongst the Sunni Not the majority. Some among the Sunni will follow the Imam al-Mahdi. The rest of the Sunnis will say, no, he's a terrorist. That kind of Islam can't work in the world today. And they reject it. And so I'm sure that in Iran there are lawyers who will have authentic loyalty at that time and will therefore have a role to play in the world post-Malkhan. What that role is going to be, I don't think we can encompass that in our lecture tonight.
Salam Sheikh, yes. Islam is supposed to lead mankind out of this quagmire. If we look at the Muslim more generously, for me personally, they take interest in this. In many instances, you get so-called Muslim countries or leaders that assist this kind of gajal people, and the message is being led onto a very dangerous road. So who is going to take the initiative to try and shape, not only in this life, but what life to come for the future? Because to me personally, it's only in isolated cases that some of our ulamas come on the individual basis, where they, to me personally, should come in a grand scale and try and ponder.
I'm very happy for this question. How do we recognize within our world of Islam? How do we recognize those who are betraying us and those who are faithful to Allah and His Messenger? This brings us to eschatology. My study of eschatology has led me to the conclusion that when the Dajjal was in a day which is like a year, he did more to create the first ruling state of Pax Britannica. He did more than controlling money with the now UN, I mean the sterling pound monetary system. What he did was to create within the world of Islam those who will rule the world of Islam on the child's behalf. And that was the so-called Ottoman Islamic Empire. And I have done my studies, oh yes, I assure you, before I speak these words. And when the Dajjal moved to a day which is like a month, he did more than create the United States of America and Pax Americana with the US dollar. He created within the world of Islam a successor to the Ottoman Empire, which will take leadership in the world of Islam on the Dajjal's behalf. And that was the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. And when the Dajjal is to move to a day which is like a week, and Pax Judaica is to replace Pax America, and the electronic and digital monetary system is to replace the petrodollar monetary system, he creates ISIS, which is destined to now replace Saudi Arabia with a bogus caliphate of Khilafah. That is my answer to you. This is how we recognize the head of the snake. Incidentally, this is the first time tonight, first time in my life I've ever made this comment. Go ahead.
Sheikh, my question is slightly off topic, but I wanted to know about Dajjal and your interpretation of the eye being a spiritual eye of blindness, whereas in the hadith that I read, it was like a protruding grape. So how do you interpret, why do you interpret the one like that and not alike, in a physical
okay,
sense?
Okay, we're not here at the beginning of the lecture then.
This one?
This one. You were not here at the beginning.
Where you said about the Muhkamat and
that's
the
Shabbat. Right, that there are ahadiths which have to be interpreted, like the ayat of the Quran, which have to be interpreted. However, if you wish to wait for the Mountain of of the metal to come out of the river, you can wait. If you want to wait for the flying donkey, you can wait. And if you want to wait for somebody who is tied up in Jerusalem, and he has one eye, and paid to be Dajjal, you will have to explain to me how come Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam suspected Ibn Sayyad to be Dajjal, and he had two eyes. Next question.
You've already outlined very much your answers as well with regards to Dajjal coming from the east on the flying donkey. But now the question that follows is that Dajjal, would he have a body until he appears as a day like a day like a day, a real day, this is what it says here. So if Dajjal after the Malchama that would come from the east, still not in human body, and how can it be from the east?
I thought I had already explained, maybe I did not. That when his day, like a week, is finished. Sorry. When the conquest of Constantinople has taken place, has it taken place again? Is Sultan Muhammad Fatih the man that the Prophet spoke about when he started? The Turkish people will be furious with me. They'll wring my neck if I go to Turkey now. Is Sultan Muhammad Fatih the man that Nabi Muhammad al-Islam spoke about when he praised it? لَتَفْتَحَنَّ الْقُنْسْتَنْتِنِيَةِ وَلَنِعْمَ الْأَمِيرُ أَمِيرُهَا وَلَنِعْمَ الْجَيْشُ ذَلِكَ الْجَيْشُ. You will most certainly conquer Constantinople. And what a wonderful army that would be, what a great commander that would be. Sultan Muhammad Fatih led the Ottoman troops and conquered Constantinople in 1452. Is that what the Prophet al-Islam was talking about? Or are you going to come now with some bogus theory and bogus epiphany? No, there are two conquests of Constantinople to get out of the mess in which you are. No. The Prophet spoke of only one conquest of Constantinople, and it did not as yet occur. No. It is only after the conquest of Constantinople that you will have the Khuruj of Dajjal. The Khuruj of Dajjal means that a day which is like a week has now come to an end. And his day was sa'iru ayyamihi ka'ayyamikum. And his day is now like our day. So he is in our world of space and of time. And he's going to appear as a human being. Not only does he have to appear as a human being, but more than that, we have to know who was his papa and who was his mama. Yes, because no Jew will accept him as the Messiah unless and until you see the lineage. With dogs it's called pedigree, with human beings it's called lineage. Who is his father, mother, grandfather, to ensure that he's come from the house of Dawood alayhi salam. So when Dajjal comes flying on the donkey after the Malchama, it will be Dajjal in human form. Next question.
The question is that early in your response about Iran, Pakistan, you mentioned that you would like to know who then controls Pakistan and Iran.
Is that you have to have a fatwa. And the fatwa cannot be issued by a schoolboy or by a student in a Darul Uloom. The fatwa has to be issued by a scholar of commanding rank, respected by his peers, because you're dealing with a whole community. And that fatwa has to be written with all the arguments and dalil. When that fatwa is written, it then has to be studied by those who have the competence to study it, the ulama. And when they are in agreement and you have ijma', the ulama, as we had on the Qadiani of the Ahmadi, then you can say that the Shia are the kuffar. Otherwise, watch it. Watch it. Watch it. Otherwise, you make a fool of yourself. Okay? Yes, I know you can have arguments about Shia conduct and this and that and the other. There's no problem with that. But to say that they are kuffar, no, there's a procedure. If that had been done in the last 1300 years, then how come the Shia have been performing the Hajj unmolested? Unmolested? With no obstacles in their way placed by any regime in control of the Hijaz and the Hajj. And without demonstrations in Cape Town or any other part of the world. No, 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 they should not be allowed, they are not Muslims. In my living, and I am 73 years, long years now on the face of this earth, and I have never come across any demonstration in any part of the world protesting the Shia performing the Hajj. And I think it's a little late now to come up with this fatwa that the Shia are kuffar. If they're not kuffar, then you must conduct yourselves in a manner that is becoming. A manner that is becoming. I go to Iran. And I say to them, very plainly and clearly I say, that the belief system of Islam has to come from the Quran. Because Allah says of the Quran that it is tibyan and likulli shay, it explains all things. So it has to tell me who is a Muslim, the belief system of Islam. Who therefore is to be the ruler of the Muslims? And the belief system cannot come from the mutashabihat. It has to come from the muhkamat, because this is Ummul Kitab. So don't come to me with any ta'wil or interpretation of any verse of the Quran, because that's the door. That's the door. Tell me where in the muhkamat of the Quran do we find that Allah has ordained the leadership of the Ummah is restricted to the house of the Prophet ﷺ. The theory of the Imam. It's not there. Therefore, if you divide the house of Islam on a matter which is not to be found in the Muhkamat of the Quran, you're going to have to answer to Allah. And guess what? Because I don't go to them with boxing gloves, I don't speak ill to them. No. They listen to me respectfully. And some of them have started to reflect over what I have said. Oh yes. And they invite me to come again. So I say at this time when Dajjal wants to provoke Sunni Shia civil war, then your leader and my leader, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would want us to respond with efforts to build Shia Sunni solidarity to confront the common enemy.
Take two more questions.
If I understand it correctly, you're asking about the Russian situation and the relationship between the Russian people and the Muslim people in Russia.
There are 20 million Muslims in the Russian Federation. 20 million Muslims in the Russian Federation. Something like, I think, 40% of the Russian armed forces are Muslims. Something like 40% of the Russian armed forces are Muslims. Yeah. It is when the CIA, and before the CIA was Britain, want to stab Russia in the back. That there was funny weapons and money, sterling pounds and weapons, to try to provoke Muslims into an armed rebellion. Did you find these Russian Muslim wars taking place? But that was not the only reason why the Russians made war on Muslims. There's another reason. This latest one in Chechnya is because the CIA was fishing in Chechnya with US dollars and with US weapons. And if you don't know that, go and ask the Chechens themselves and they'll tell you. But prior to this, how do we explain that Allah in the Quran has said, has commanded, if you differ with my explanation of the verse, say so tonight. Surah Al-Ma'idah. O you who have faith in Allah, ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who have faith in Allah. لا تتخذوا اليهود والنصارى أولياء بعضهم أولياء بعض ومن يتولهم منكم فإنه منهم إن الله لا يهدي القوم الظالمين. All you who have faith, do not take such Jews and do not take such Christians as your friends and allies who بعضهم أولياء بعض. Who? بعضهم أولياء بعض. Shall I repeat it a third time? Who are themselves friends and allies of each other? The Quran is prohibiting us from maintaining friendly ties and becoming allies and accepting sterling pounds and weapons from a Judeo-Christian alliance, when Jews and Christians become allies of each other. And if you do that, you've lost your Islam, you belong to them. And Allah will not provide guidance for a wicked people. And here comes the Ottoman Empire. And the Ottoman Empire for 500 years wages a bogus jihad. A bogus jihad. On whom? Who is whom? Go to Surah Al-Rum and you know who is whom. Ghulibat al-Rum and you know who is whom. Rum is the Orthodox Christian world which never, never, never entered into an alliance with the Jews. Up to this day. So who entered into the alliance with the Jews? It is the Western Christian world. It is Britain who led the way. And it was Britain who was fishing out there, sending weapons and money to Imam Shafi. The Ottoman Empire waged war on Rome, unjust war, for 500 years. Only on the Orthodox Christians. The Ottoman Empire took the capital city of Rome and took the Khilafah of Islam and brought it to sit down right there in the capital city of Rome. If there was any humiliation to the rule of Rome, this is it. Took the greatest cathedral of Rome, Hagia Sophia, or Hagia Sophia, which has been the greatest cathedral for 1,000 years, and wickedly, monstrously wickedly and sinfully and shamefully transformed it into a masjid. If you want to defend what they did, come on and say so. Let's have it up. I say, what you did was shameful, because Allah in the Quran asks us to protect not just the masjid, but the synagogue and the church. This there in Surah Al-Hajj. And so Rome was bleeding. They waged war on Rome, and when they defeated any Christian, Orthodox Christian people, they would sign an agreement for ceasefire, and they would have to pay tribute, anfal. And part of the anfal, shamelessly, maliciously, sinfully, disgracefully, never before in the history of Islam have any people shamed us as much as the Ottomans. Who is this? That they had to hand over a certain number of Christian boys as part of the tribute. And these Christian boys would be converted to Islam. And if you did not, you'd be killed. And they will now be trained to become the Janissary fighting force, the elite fighting force of the Ottoman Empire. And so when the Ottoman army went to fight against the Christians, your own sons would be fighting against you. Would you excuse these people for hating Muslims? Huh? And then they would take the woman and enslave them. And the Ottoman sultans never married. Why? It's only with their milk al-yameen, they'll have children. So a sultan is always the son of a Christian woman. So when the Ottoman army comes to you, it is your own son who is leading them against you. These things are not happening by accident. What the Ottoman Empire was doing all through these 500 wicked years was to sabotage the end time alliance between Muslims and the people who Allah has spoken of in the Quran, saying, وَلَتَجِدَنَّ أَقْرَبَهُمْ مَوَدَّةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّا نَصَارَى. That a Christian people will be the closest in love and affection for you. And I say that those Christian people are whom? For when they defeated, when they were victorious, وَيَوْمَئِذٍ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, we celebrated. And so the wars that the Tsarist Russia fought against Christians, Muslims, and wars we could understand because of the hatred they had for Islam. But that hatred is coming now. I went to Russia, yes, in July 2013. And I went to the greatest university in Russia, the State University of Moscow, and I lectured there. And I was received with respect. Yes. They listened to me with respect. And we even parted with affection. They were very happy to hear that the center, the heart of Islamic eschatology was not what the Iranians had taught them. The Iranians have taught them that the heart of Islamic eschatology is the advent of Imam al-Mahdi. So when I went to Russia, all I'm hearing is Mahdi, 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 Mahdi. And I said, no, you're wrong. The sign of all signs of Akhir al-Zaman is not the advent of Imam al-Mahdi. The Shia are wrong. It is the return of the son of Mary, and when I said that, you could have seen the smiles on their faces. They were so happy. They say, but your eschatology and ours is the same. And when I spoke of the conquest of Constantinople, they say, but your eschatology and ours is the same. And they embraced me with affection. And they invited me to come back. And so 500 years of Ottoman wickedness. But Allah can grant his plans, and Allah's plan is the best plan.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. We say shukran to